Welcome back. Thank you for staying with us this far. We want to continue with the program. And right now we want to move on to the next discussion. And this is all about the forthcoming International Day for Persons with a Disability that will be marked this Friday, the 3rd of December, a day that has been set aside to focus on matters concerning persons living with disabilities. Now, to help us with this conversation today, I have three guests with me in studio this morning. I'll start with a lady to my immediate right. She is Phoebe Nyagudi, who is the Director for Social Development at the Ministry of Public Service, Gender, Senior Citizen Affairs and Special Programs. Good morning and karibu sana. Next to her, we have Father Peter Wambulwa, who is a member of the Dawn Orione Fathers. Karibu sana, Father.
Thank you.
Thank you for making time to be with us. And to my extreme right, we have Richard Manyara, who is the project manager at Orione Community Training Center. Good morning, Richard.
Good morning, Jane.
Thank you for making time to be with us today.
Asante sana.
All right. Now, let me start with you, Phoebe. Now, in line with the forthcoming International Day of Persons with Disabilities, let's start by understanding your representation under the Ministry, of course, of Public Service and Special Programs, looking at the Social Development Department. Tell us a bit about that.
Thank you very much, Madam, and I say good morning to all of us. As a department for social development, we are with the Ministry of Public Service, Gender, Senior Citizens Affairs, and Social and Special Programs in the State Department of Social Protection, Senior Citizen Affairs, and Special Programs. And I come from the Directorate of Social Development, actually where this is seated. It is the responsibility of the department, together with the stakeholders, you know, to mark this day. It's a day that has been marked severally from 1992.
Yes.
Yes, and it is a day that is very important to persons with disabilities, the government, and the society as a whole. It's a day that people with disabilities, they have to come together and celebrate themselves. You know, look at yourself. What have you achieved in the whole year? What are some of the, you know, the targets that you set for yourself as an individual, as a country, or even as a worker where you work? What are some of the targets that you have put down that you want to achieve? So at this time, we just come and evaluate what we have achieved so far, and celebrate where we have done well, and where we have challenges or met challenges, we can make strategies on how to go about the strategies.
All right.
Yeah, so it's just a day for celebrating ourselves and celebrating the people that have worked with us and brought us so far.
All right.
Yes.
Now, let me come to you, Father Peter Wambulwa, as a member of the Dawn Orione Fathers. What do you represent as an organization?
Okay, fine. I should start by saying, our congregation was founded in Italy in 1895 by Saint Luigi Orione. He said, according to history and what we have seen written, that in every person shines the image of God.
Yes.
So he was powered by this message and he felt that it was good. He looked around in the society and felt that people with the disability, I'm sorry, because I've been told that the language has changed. So I'm addressing as a priest, not as a specialist in the language of what Phoebe could perhaps tell me at the end of the show. That according to him, he felt that the people who are having some disability in life were kind of discriminated. So it was in his vision to begin centers to be able to care for these people. And he did it very well. He founded centers in Italy, in Brazil, in Argentina. And now, as a congregation, we work in 36 countries around the world with a vision of trying to reach especially people who have disability.
All right. Yeah. Now, let me come to you also, Richard. You know, given you are the project manager at the Orione Community Training Center, what does the center do essentially in line with a persons with disability?
Right, thank you so much. Now, just to add on what Father Peter said.
Yes.
Yes, we have the Orione Community Training Centers, and here in Kenya, we have two centers. One is in Murang'a, where we have 40 students, And the second one is in Ongata Rongai, a place called Kandisi, where we have 70 students. Now, we work with children and youth living or with disabilities, mental conditions and syndromes, conditions such as autism, cerebral palsy, and Down syndrome. Mm-hmm. And our work is organized in three main areas of special education, rehabilitation, which includes physiotherapy, occupational therapy, and speech therapy. We also have an aspect of health and nutrition. And the third area is vocational training in farming. So this is how our work is organized. And we have our students from the ages of 3 years to 18 years. So these are our activities on a day-to-day, day-to-day activity. This is what we do at the center.
Oh, fantastic. Now, I'm looking at the theme for this year, which is leadership and participation of persons with disabilities towards an inclusive, accessible, and sustainable post-COVID-19 world. Let me come back to you, Phoebe. Looking at this particular theme, because for so many years, we've always been talking about inclusivity and participation when it comes to persons with disability. How much progress have we made as a country?
We have made some progress. Mm-hmm. I can't say that we have really reached there.
Yes.
But a lot has happened, because formerly you find that there was a lot of stigma associated with people with disabilities, where it was felt that if you have a disability, you cannot lead. If you have a disability, you cannot perform. And therefore, there was that, you know, people look down upon you, that even if you are given a responsibility to be a leader, you will not be able to measure up to, you know, yes, the requirements. But we have seen a lot of improvement in that line. Why? Because we have put laws in place, laws that really discriminate or outlaw discrimination, mm-hmm, to persons with disabilities. And again, what has really worked for us are the affirmative action measures,
yes,
that have been put in place. And these are put in place to ensure the people who have been left out are somehow also given the ability to come up, and so that we have a level playing ground. Mm-hmm. So the affirmative action measures have really supported persons with disabilities to be able, you know, to be considered as leaders. And I can say that, for example, there is a requirement in every government that 5% of employment, not only in the government but also in the private sector, 5% of people that they employ, mm-hmm, should be persons with disabilities.
Yes.
You know, that one give a leeway to bring people with disabilities on board. And when you bring them on board, you will train them, you will make them useful members, and they'll become leaders. Mm. Yeah. So those measures that have been put in place has really worked for us.
Okay.
Yes.
Let me come to you, Father. You know, when we talk about inclusivity for all persons, and this also includes persons living with disabilities, from where you stand, how does that look like?
Can I say this, that looking at the example that we have in our project, persons with disability in the beginning were considered to be full-time dependents on others to do things for themselves.
Yes.
So in line with the theme of this year, necessarily not to be a leader to lead somebody else, but among the activities that we really want to highlight, the center is able to help these young, the children and the young youth to do one thing that I believe even you like, to use toilets by their own. Mm. So the center has able to train, has been able to train most of those young people to go to toilet by their own, which something in the beginning was you have to do everything for them. So this for us we feel is a good progress.
Yes.
And also the project as we look forward to it is to help them lead their own lives,
mm-hmm,
be free, so that they don't sit in the corners of streets asking people to give them money, but they can do their own life. And one thing I must say before I end is that the center also has an area where perhaps Richard will highlight more.
Yes.
This is a place where we have farming project.
Mm-hmm.
And some of those young, the youth, grow their own vegetables. And at the end of the day, even if they leave the center at the age of 18, 20, 21, they're able to manage their own life.
All right.
That is a sign of leadership. So leadership, according to me, is not necessarily I have to lead you. but also be in position to manage your own life. Mm-hmm. And this makes parents to be free so that the parents with the children or youth with disability can get time to do other things rather than sitting in one place taking care of one family member, and yet they could be having other siblings. Mm.
Leadership to you is empowering the other individuals to be able to stand on their themselves. Mm. Now let me come to you, Richard. You know, looking at this aspect of inclusivity, clearly inequality has been a problem that has fueled the aspect of inclusivity. From where you sit as the project manager, how are you going about to just ensure that equality is maintained and inclusivity is something that each and every individual gets to enjoy regardless of the disability that may be in place?
Thank you. If I look back from where or when the center started practically 10 years ago,
yes,
and make a comparison on where we are, and I agree with Madam Phoebe that yes, we are making progress. But there is still much more that we can do, especially when we start to talk about matters to do with inclusivity and equality. Why do we have much more to do? It's because there is a lack of an awareness about disability. And people tend to think that if you have a disability, you have negated your rights as a human being. Mm. So the first step for us really is to create an awareness. And that's why the 3rd of December is really an important day for us, just to further this agenda of awareness creation on disability rights, the inclusion that we are advocating for, and also the participation of persons with disability in our societies and in our communities. For us as an institution, really, we've been trying to do this by through our living testimony, through our daily activities, where we are able to go around our villages picking up our students and bringing them to the center using our buses and our transport system. Just this aspect that the mother or the family is encouraged to bring out their child to the pickup point is already trying to create an awareness. Because when we create this awareness, then people tend to know that these children are with us. This reality is present. But then there's another gap when you look at this progress that we are trying to make. When you look at the context of the laws that are there, in the national context and the international context, so many laws are there,
yes,
so many frameworks, so many institutions, offices. But then there's a very big gap between the law and the impact that it has on the daily life of persons with disability. And that's why we are here today, just to talk about this, how we can bring the law, the offices, the institutions to really impact in a very practical way, mm-hmm, in the lives of persons with disability, and especially children and youth with intellectual disabilities, because for us they are the most vulnerable.
Mm-hmm.
The capacity to take consent, to give consent, is not there, but then we tend to keep them in the corners, we tend to assume them simply because people are not aware.
Right.
And in this ignorance,
yes,
that's where all the discrimination, the stigma, the stereotyping is coming from.
And you know, that's actually one of the areas that, you know, most people struggle with when it comes to visible and invisible disabilities. And I like the fact that you've brought in the aspect of invisible disabilities, because now, how then can we improve awareness among the greater part of the population to understand that even invisible disabilities still constitute disabilities that need to be understood and also include these individuals in each aspect of everyone's life?
Thank you. That's a good one, because we tend to, I don't want to say promote or rather concentrate in one aspect of disability than the other, but again, the underlying factor is the ignorance.
Mm-hmm.
And that's why, together with partners, just like recently, we just concluded a joint workshop on disability awareness, a joint workshop that we did together with the Strathmore University School of Law and the Embassy of Chile here in Nairobi, where we had a training for people working in this reality, professionals, police officers, local authorities, nurses, teachers, just to try and bring this topic to them. And the best way we can really advocate for that is to try and mainstream and make conscious that there are other disabilities apart from the common ones that we know. Mm-hmm. Because again, mental conditions and syndromes are invisible, but people aren't aware. So through these workshops, practical skills and training, just to tell a police officer, look, if a child is lost and is brought to the police station mm-hmm. and is not able to express himself, probably he could be living with a condition of autism. But then nobody is aware about these conditions. Nobody knows how to treat a child or a person with an intellectual disability because this awareness is not there. So the only way is to try and mainstream mental conditions and syndromes in the curriculums that we have. Like for instance, on the 3rd of December, we are inviting to our institution because we'll be celebrating this important day at the Don Orione Center. We are inviting universities, mm-hmm. Hospitals that we have already invited, primary schools, secondary schools, local authorities, to come and interact with this reality, because that's the only way. We need to come out of our comfort zone and go and meet this reality on the ground, and then look for ways that we can really, in a very clear way, get to know the challenges that they go through. Because the moment we do that, the moment we see this reality, we cannot remain indifferent. We cannot remain ignorant. So it's an invitation for us now to start to enter into this reality, because it's not an easy one.
Yes.
You can imagine, it's not easy, it's not cheap, it's very expensive, because you need to have barrier-free environments, you need to have medical assessment, you need to have the intervention. Like we said, we work in three main areas. That already in itself shows you how important it is to have a multidiscipline approach when you talk about mental conditions and syndromes. So the first step for us is an invitation to come out and meet this reality where it is. That's the only way that is possible to see the testimony and the progress that we want to see tomorrow.
All right. Now, let me come back to you, Phoebe. Looking at our country, given we are ripe in the political season, and that comes in both levels of the government. From where you sit, from where you stand, do we have the political goodwill to ensure that even persons with disabilities are involved in something as grand as the elections that are forthcoming?
I think they do. The government, we have that goodwill. Mm-hmm. Because one thing, what is important is that the structures must be put in place. Once the structures are put in place,
yes.
I think enforcement is what is left. Yeah, it is a requirement that in every county, there should be representation of persons with disabilities. Mm-hmm. So it is up to us, people with disabilities who are politically minded, to make use of that, provision that has been given to us.
Okay.
And I know that when you go outside there are many organizations that really support in civil education to ensure that people know their rights and that they can be counted. They can also participate in politics. Yeah, so that I think is important, because it is already in our political laws mm-hmm. that persons with disabilities are encouraged, to be part and parcel of politics. And at the same time, they are political parties. Yeah, they're supposed to be able, to accommodate or to embrace mm-hmm. persons with disabilities. That when they do their nominations, they should think about, ensuring that persons with disabilities are also nominated, because most people cannot go to this. There are people try to go for elections. To there are some of us that have been elected mm-hmm. as members of parliament and as women reps and all that. But I think a lot needs to be done. It is expensive.
Mm-hmm.
People may not be able. Persons with disabilities may not be able to do it. Because you need to move around. You need to go and talk to people. Tell them your manifesto, what you want to do for them. So it is important that you move around. So sometimes what is really putting people down is they are not able, because they don't have the resources to enable them do that.
Okay.
But they can do it, because that everybody is allowed to do it.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, and then the other thing that I wanted to say is that when we have structures in place, for example, a lot of what he has talked about, is marginalization of persons with disabilities. People thinking that when you have a disability, you cannot lead. So unless we create that awareness, and that is why the government has a structure in place where from the lowest level, in this country, we have lay counselors. These lay counselors are supposed to help the country, the families, you know. We are trying to strengthen the families so that the families will be able to, you know, look at their children as any other children,
yes,
whether they have disability or they don't,
mm,
so that at that level they can support them to do what they really like for themselves.
Okay.
Yeah, because if that awareness is not created from that level, people may not come out, you know, to exploit their potentials.
Mm-hmm.
So we say the families should be strengthened so that they take their children to be the same, make them go to school, yeah, help them go to school. And this idea of stigma and marginalization of families, you know, when you have a disability, it is not only me, Phoebe, that is going to be marginalized.
Mm-hmm.
It is also my people, my parents, my brothers. Yeah, they are associated with me.
Mm-hmm.
So there's that stigma. And because of that, people tend to conceal children with disability.
Yes.
And when we conceal them, we are denying them the right to participate. We are denying them the right to go out and pursue their potentials. So it is important that that awareness is created and people come to realize that whatever people are saying about disability, that if you have a disability, it must be a bad omen.
Mm-hmm.
If you have a disability. So these things really put families, they don't want to release their children to go out. They don't want to release even their elder people with disabilities to go out and, you know, fight for their right. You know, some of these positions are not given. You have to go and fight for them.
Mm-hmm.
So if you don't have that support from your own family or from the community where you come from, it is difficult. It starts from the family, but it should go out of the family, and people should be able to embrace you and to support you as they support anybody else. And the idea that if you have a disability, you may not perform, those are stigmatic things that are supposed to be, you know, talked about, and people should understand that a person, once they have gone to school, once they have the necessary, you know, skills that they...
Skills and qualifications.
Yes, yeah, then they can do anything.
So that goes back to the ignorance that, you know, Richard was talking about.
Yes, yes.
All right. Now, let me come to you, Father Peter. Looking at the role of the clergy and the church as a whole, when it comes to ensure that we also get this political goodwill from our politicians in the levels that you interact with them, what do you feel is the responsibility that you have as the clergy to ensure that politicians understand that inclusivity involves every individual?
Okay, for the church runs a lot of such institutions, because
mm-hmm,
if we could go around and count around Nairobi, I know Cheshire Homes, I know Mother Teresa, I know Donor Rione Fathers, I know quite a number of congregational priests and nuns who take care of people with disability. So, the as I said in the beginning, number one is to recognize that they are created in the image and likeness of God,
yes,
and therefore they need movement. They come to church, we see them, some of them are very qualified. So in jobs where they, for example, we cannot ask them to sprint like Omanyala, because that they cannot do. But we can even organize sports that are in their level. That much we've tried, and I really want to thank the church, because I've seen these days when they build, for example, once again on the issue about lavatories, I've
mm-hmm
seen that they build lavatories and they're always indicating this is for the people who have disability, and this is for the always, there is that kind of, as Richard has said, awareness among the society that these people, they are like us. So we need to create places for them in all areas. If we need a secretary, if she is using hands, let her get the job. But so we don't say somebody has to have this and that before he's given this job. So I believe on the area of the church, we've done our best trying to recognize them, not necessarily to give them opportunities where it's possible. And also, even if we don't give them opportunity to work, but we also feed them. It is part of the demands of the church, the seven acts of goodwill. One of them is to feed the hungry. So the church does a lot of charity to feed families of people who have disability.
Okay.
On that much, we recognize, and the church does a good job there.
All right. Now, Richard, looking at the fact that even the theme is quoting a sustainable post-COVID-19 world, how has the pandemic, you know, affected the gains that we had made when it comes to conversations involving persons with disabilities?
yes, the pandemic has affected persons with disabilities maybe 3 times more as compared to other people or other sectors of the communities and societies.
Mm-hmm.
But for us, it has been different, really. COVID-19 for Don Orione Center has been really an instance to show to our community first in Ongata Rongai and where we serve that those that we think are disabled are actually the most able. Why am I saying this? When the COVID started in 2019,
mm-hmm.
the first case, you know, everybody was scared, everybody closed down, and all these things happened. But for us working in the community setup, it was really quite a challenge for us, because when we tell our students to stay home, and this child does not only depend on the education part, the mm-hmm. academical part. He or she doesn't depend on only this. She also depends on rehabilitation. Physiotherapy is very important for them, occupational therapy, speech therapy, and also the life skills training.
Yes.
So it was quite a challenge for us how to really manage this situation. So yes, we followed the protocols, we had to close down, but then we had to have a system whereby we did home visits
mm-hmm.
just to follow up on the children at home. But then also this tended to be a bit challenging to implement
mm-hmm.
because then of the protocols and the risks that were coming in. But then we looked for another alternative through the center again, through our students. We were able to create an awareness of COVID, going around the communities, training them how to make hand sanitizers, placing posters all around the places, because we felt that the sooner we are able to get over this, the faster it will be for our students to resume their normal activities. But it wasn't mainly the case, and the situation went on escalating. But then through the job that we've been able to do through the years and with the support of the donors, we started to see how our neighbors were suffering. Loss of jobs, families struggling to feed their children, the economy taking a downturn. So we made applications to a number of foundations through our center to help the community. We gave food donation, food packs to over 1,000 families, medical donation equipment to our local health dispensary, Ole Kasasi. So in this way, and also we had a feeding program for the children, 400 children for 4 months. And in that moment, if you look at it in a very deep way, those that we considered as disabled were the ones now coming back to give an answer, a reprieve,
mm-hmm.
a solution to us who we consider ourselves abled. In fact, there was an article that ran in one of the dailies, "The disabled feed the community." In that moment, people started to appreciate really the presence of children and youth with intellectual disabilities in our village, because it is them who are able to feed us when we aren't able to do it in the normal way that we used to do before. They helped us keep our doors open,
mm-hmm.
not only for them, but for the whole village around, to such a point that we entered into a memorandum of understanding with
yes.
the local county government of Kajiado, a joint emergency intervention program, where we realize now, yes, we are serving our population of 70, but we know the statistics aren't clear, but we know at least 10 to 15% of our population
mm.
lives with disabilities. So if we are serving 70, what other numbers are out there that are not able to receive this intervention? And when we did this memorandum of understanding, it was in such a manner that we needed to bring more children to the center
mm-hmm.
just to give them emergency rehabilitation to prevent them from regressing. Because you can imagine a child with cerebral palsy
mm-hmm.
missing 2 sessions of physiotherapy. They regress in just the gain that they had made maybe in 2 sessions or in a month or 6 months, because just the capacity or the ability to stretch out the arm maybe took 2 months to achieve that. Just to lift the arm, stretch out and say hi. And then we are closing down the schools for 6 months, something that is outside our scope. How many more are regressing? So through this memorandum, through this project, we were able to receive 360 children from Kajiado North sub-county coming to the center to receive emergency intervention in physiotherapy mm-hmm. and in the educational aspect. So in one way or another, COVID was an instance to show the ability that those who we consider disabled or not important in our societies, how far they can go and how much they can do for us.
Yes.
If we treat them with dignity, mm-hmm. with love, with respect, and with acceptance. And I really hope and I pray that each one of us, because also we tend to put a lot of emphasis on politicians and structures and all this, but then it's an invitation again to each and every one of us. If we do something for them, the answer maybe is three times more.
All right.
So we need
now,
to focus.
On that particular note, Richard, you know, as we bring the conversation to a close, maybe your call to action message and just how can we all join in celebrating this day that will be marked on this Friday?
How you can join in? First, definitely I would like to extend the invitation on behalf of our directors and on behalf of the center to join us at Orione Community Training Center in Kandisi, mm-hmm. to come and interact with us, to see the testimonies, what we are talking about here today, to see children who have made progress that nobody thought they would, to see youth who are running their own farming projects and income generating activities when nobody believed in them, to come and listen to our partners, our leaders who have believed in us, mm-hmm. and they also have a testimony to say this can work. So join us in celebrating at the center, okay. and also join in any other reality. Visit a home, an institution that works with people with disabilities, and learn. That is how we can make this reality more visible. And when it's more visible, when we talk about it more, we'll be pushed definitely to do much more.
All right. Let me come to you, Father Peter, in line with your call to action message and just advice on how everyone can join in marking the International Day of Persons with Disability this Friday.
Okay. I'll get to what Professor Wangari Maathai,
yes.
when she speaks about a burning forest and everybody was there complaining that the forest is burning. But then she speaks about a little hummingbird that goes around bringing water and trying to put off the fire in the forest. Looks like the big birds go around saying, what time will that fire go off with your little beak? What time will you put off the fire? But then the bird answers in that story of Professor that I'm doing my part. I'm just putting off the fire that I'm able. So there are so many people with a lot of disability in Kenya, mm-hmm. and elsewhere in Uganda, in Tanzania, and all over the world. At this moment, we as a center, we are just putting off the fire where we can. And the call is to allow as many Kenyans as possible to accept that we have people with disability. They are people created in the image and likeness of God. They have capacity. They can do as well as we can do. We can give them opportunities, we can grant them all the necessary work, then they can give us always a good result.
Right.
And as I want to say, as Richard has said, during the COVID-19, when it came in immediately, we felt that was the moment where the families can come forward and bring forth these children or youth to have food. Even if they are, because many families stopped going to work. So it was more difficult for them at home to feed them.
Yes.
And in that context, I believe that the center did a good job by asking the families to bring these people in the center and at least have a meal just to put off a little fire.
All right. Put out the fire in your... Do what you were supposed to do. Mm-hmm. Play your part. Now, Phoebe, also maybe tell us a bit about the expected activities from your department and also your message to our viewers today when it comes to the International Day of Persons with Disabilities.
Thank you very much. This year is as any other year, and the day of 3rd of December is a very important day for all of us. As my colleagues have said here, that is a day that we create a lot about awareness about issues of disabilities, what programs are going on around in the country, mm. where do we can they get services when they need them. So this is the day that people come and even exhibit what they do so that people can get to know that if I need this problem, this is where I can go and get it. So this year round, as we do it every year, every county in this country will be celebrating the day in their own levels. Yeah, where normally they are being convened, those committees are convened by the county commissioners,
okay.
and then other and other officers within the county, mm-hmm. particularly the disability officers within the country, the social development officers, they come together and other stakeholders, and at that level, they bring people together to celebrate the day of disability. But during that time, we normally, rotationally, we go to various counties to celebrate it nationally.
Okay.
This year round, it is going to be celebrated in Nairobi, mm-hmm. and we are going to have it at Kenya, at the KICC Conference Center, where we are expecting that people within Nairobi will come there for the celebrations. Okay. What we are going to do on that particular day, bring us together, we will be singing, we will be making merry.
All right.
And then we will expect that our guest of honor mm-hmm. will speak to us, telling us what the government has achieved.
Okay.
And what is there for persons with disabilities and how they can explore.
All right.
Can I just potential. Say something?
We can. We have to end at this particular point. We have over an actually, but we have to bring this conversation to a close due to the interest of time. Remember, we'll be marking the International Day of Persons with Disabilities this Friday, not today. It is on the 3rd of December. And with us in studio, we have been speaking with Phoebe Nyagudi, who is the Director for Social Development under the Ministry of Public Service and Special Programs. Richard Magana, who is the project manager at Orione Community Training Center, and Father Peter Wambulwa, a member of the Don Orione Fathers. Thank you so much, ladies and gentlemen. With that, we bring to a close Good Morning Kenya. Thank you so much. See you tomorrow. I'm Jane Wambui.